with how I step into spaces, truly believing and walking in spaces where I believe in my heart of souls that I am supernatural, believing in my heart of souls that I am God's child, ordained from a higher spirit with a bigger purpose to execute at the highest level so I don't disappoint my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Those are my beliefs, and that's what I've been told. What I've also been told is that those are the same reasons why I have been able to make some of my dreams come true. And so what I'm doing today is not patronizing you in any way, shape, or form, but to lay down some commitments and hopefully get some non-negotiables for you in your mind ruminating around here. And so I want to rewind a little bit to remind you where actually you are. You are inside of an organization called Equity Now. I named the company Equity Now because I firmly believe fundamentally in my heart of hearts that kids in our community couldn't wait for a change and that we needed to be expeditious with a forceful flow of energy to disrupt mediocrity in our local community. So that's why Equity Now is the name of the company. You are working at a place called Legends Charter School. That was also an intentionally picked name. I didn't say mediocre charter school. I didn't say sub-average. I didn't say just okay charter school. I named it Legends Charter School because that's a homophone. It's what I believe they will be, and I believe that's what they are. A legend is the key, but a legend is something you also aspire to, right? And so thumbs up if you can understand and accept my framework of how this came to me. Perfect. And so at our company retreat, we've been doing a lot of inside work on how to be better leaders for you. And so I delivered a TED Talk on learning to be legendary. And so if you were at that retreat, I won't be a complete repeat, but what I want to make known to you guys is I'm punctuating a piece of my childhood to be less long and less involved in that story. The way I summarize it for friends who I can't really get deep into is that I was, raise your hand if you are an X-Men fan or you know anything about cartoons and superheroes and that, right? So Professor X, Dr. Xavier, he had this school for the gifted mutants, right? They had special gifts. And he worked and pulled kids who had exceptionalities into this school so that they could hone in on their powers, right? And so that they could go out in the world and coexist with humans as mixed mutants. Natasha, why are you saying this to us? That's how I believe I was raised, right? I went to a school for gifted and talented kids, and I was given an opportunity to hone in on who I wanted to be when I grew up and make a plan and break through odds. And so what I want to share with you is part of my journey on how I came up so that we all understand that what we're here perpetuating and putting out to our community is only based on the stuff that my real life is made of, right? And so I'm the second of five siblings. My parents were not college educated. They were beyond poor and got trapped into a cycle of dreaming without money. They were very ambitious. My mother had the work ethic of a titan, but she also had five kids that she couldn't really afford to support. We didn't have supports in place. At 10 years old, fifth grade, I was making dinner for my siblings. At 10 years old, I was taking my sister to cross country meets with me. At 10 years old, I was up at night making her bottle because we're 11 years apart. Why am I telling you this? As I tripped over the extension cord that ran from my house to my grandmother's house often to keep my refrigerator on and to go over to her house where I could be in a place where the lights came on and the heat really ran through the house, I decided at a young age what I was going to be and what I firmly was not going to be. I placed all my effort and energy into manifesting a future that I wanted, not the future that my parents wanted, not the future that society said to me on TV I had to have. And so along the way, there was a few inspirations for me that helped me to do this, but my time away from my childhood helped me to reflect on a few things that I shared with my team. And it's very simple to me at this point. Anything that is worth fighting for, anything worthwhile, it's gonna take time, attention, and that is manifested in a commitment. Are you committed? Do you have a crazy commitment to whatever it is? Are you disciplined enough to obey that commitment? And do you trust your dopeness? And so while you may not today, the goal is, as a part of a legendary community committed to equity now, that you will literally go to the depths of your soul to figure out, what, if at all, am I committed to? Because if it's not education, you should go and pursue that commitment. You owe it to yourself. You only get one shot. But if it's not the commitment of you being a part of a legendary organization committed to excellence and equity now, you gotta make that. You have to answer those things that are going in between your head as these words are coming out of my mouth. Are you gonna be disciplined? Because with the trials, right? I taught for almost 10 years. And my first 3 years were horrible. The first year, they probably should have sent me like to teacher jail because I was just that bad. But I was committed. I had a clinical approach to my teaching. I had people come in and study me. I wanted to know, tell me everything I'm not doing well right now so that I can cement good habits. I came in knowing. I didn't come in to be a teacher to just be okay. If I was going to go off path, off script, because my original goal was to be a doctor until I developed an incurable aversion to blood that rendered me hyperventilating and unable to communicate, that threw off my path. But I was good at science, and I loved doing the work of teaching and that kind of thing. And so, but I had to trust myself and trust the dopeness in there. So those three things we're gonna come back to. I wanna share with you a piece of song that is a very, very, very well-written and an author who I admire tremendously. And she shares words about a single story, right? And what happens when even my own single story is the one that everyone comes to accept. Every single person here, every woman in this country, in these United States of America, has paid a different kind of tax just to be where you are today. Whether it was somebody doubting you, whether it was somebody catcalling you, whether it was somebody who wouldn't give you a shot. Those stories live. For a woman of color in this country today to be soft, to not have to be so rough and tough for her survival, to have to be a lion, those are narratives that have come up over the years and the expectation placed on your shoulders, and you're still paying tax on a lot of that. And so what if you want tomorrow to be different? I know for me, having a daughter, I don't want her to have to be as tough as my mother was or as tough as her grandmother was. I want to be able to continue to aggressively make pathways so that she don't have to go through some of the crap that I went through and endured. Hence, why we're here, right? Because people who create and make the spaces and make the tables, we also get to make the rules. And so how we accept a woman in today's 21st century society are largely predicated on the experiences of our leadership team, the best and the worst. And I wanted to share this with you because it's particularly powerful, and I want to be able to share some things with you. We're going to have a discussion.
We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful, otherwise you will threaten the man. Because I am female, I am expected to aspire to marriage. I'm expected to make my life choices, always keeping in mind that marriage is the most important. A marriage can be a system of joy and love and mutual support. But why do we teach girls to aspire to marriage and we don't teach boys the same? We raise girls to see each other as competitors, not for jobs or for accomplishments, which I think can be a good thing, but for their attention with men. We teach girls that they cannot be sexual beings in the way that boys are. Feminist, a person who believes in the social, political, and economic equality of the sexes.
You wake up.
We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful, otherwise you will threaten the man. Because I am female, I'm expected to aspire to marriage. I'm expected